warm in the north. Well, corrupt former Labor MP Eddie Obeid's dirty laundry has been hung out to dry with the launch of a new book. Kate McClymont, well-known investigative reporter, and Linton Bisa, who I've never heard of, have now released their book, He Who Must Be Obeid. Is that a play on words? I'm pretty sure that's a play on words. Launched by former Labor Premier Maurice Yeaman. Take a look.
To what is a very valuable, very important and groundbreaking contribution to this whole sad, dark, evil saga.
A string of corruption findings have been made against Eddie Obeid since he left State Parliament in 2011. He's now one of a number of corrupt figures who have been kicked out of the Labor Party for good. All right, to debate, I guess, the week in politics, but some of the issues of the day as well, I'm joined now by Liberal MP, Marginal Seat MP, David Coleman. He joins me here in the studio. Thanks for your company.
Good to be here, Pat.
And from the CBD studio, Senator Lee Rhiannon, you're not prepared to get out of the inner city. Thanks for joining us all the same.
Hello.
let me start with you, Senator Rhiannon, if I can, just quickly, because we're going to talk about some other domestic issues, but I know that you've had a long-held interest in Palestine and Gaza in particular, you know, vis-a-vis the blockade and a whole host of issues. I'm just interested in your thoughts on where this is at, and maybe if I could, I guess, come from the other side with the question. I saw a piece today by a senior member of the Jewish community in Sydney, I believe, in the Sydney Morning Herald, make the point that all these things, the blockade and the Israeli response, all came after Hamas started bombings rather than the other way around. He says the intractable problem here is that they just simply won't recognise the state of Israel. What's your response?
Oh, that's grossly misleading. Palestine has been occupied since 1948. So much of Palestine continues to be occupied today. I was there about 18 months ago, and these settlements that are illegal under international law, you know, and by far the majority of countries recognise that, they're like the frontline troops. They're up on the hills, often coming down for raids on Palestinian homes and land, taking that over. And then look at the situation in Gaza. You know, so many children killed. This is a massacre. You know, there should be the biggest outcry around the world. Like, I don't want to see rockets going into Israel, but let's remember, you know, Israelis are not dying like the Palestinians are.
Can I, just a quick follow-up on that before we move on to domestic issues. Do you think that a peace is ever possible, though, whatever approach Israel takes, when you have the extremist end of Hamas that aren't really representative of what a lot of Palestinians think on some issues?
By far the majority of people want to live in peace, they want to be with their families, but we need that with justice, and that means ending those security blockades across the West Bank, ending the blockade of Gaza. Like, I really believe if you were in Gaza now, you would feel that you would need to fight for your children's sake, your sake of your family. You know, like, they've taken out the only power station today. Another school was hit. I've been in Canberra all day, just heard that 20 young children killed again today. Like, there needs to be the biggest outcry. This must end.
All right, we've got some live pictures up on screen as well, Senator, while you're talking. Just a quick reaction from you, David Coleman, then we'll move on.
Yeah, look, Peter, this is an appalling situation, and you know, the pictures that we see every day, innocent people being killed, it is an appalling situation, and both sides have got to exercise restraint. It points to the fact that the only solution here in the medium term is a two-state solution, and that's where we need to focus all of our diplomatic efforts.
Yeah, I just feel like I've been here so many times, but let's move on to domestic issues and discuss that. A couple of polls this week, David Coleman, you're a marginal seat MP, no hiding that. That's what the Electoral Commission tells us. The government's not travelling well, the opinion polls are down, quite markedly so. Even the slight upsurge in Tony Abbott's personal ratings, he's still at minus 17 net satisfaction. The real concerning one, though, I would have thought, would be the Galaxy poll on the who's better to manage the economy. I mean, if there's one thing Liberals pride themselves on, you come from a business background, it's better economic managers. Well, most voters think that Bill Shorten and Labor are better placed to manage the economy, according to that Galaxy poll. That must surprise you.
Oh, Peter, look, I don't think, you know, people are walking around, you know, Riverwood Plaza with poles on their minds. You know, people are focused on their standard of living. And
they think about that, they then get asked a question by a pollster and they say that Labor's better than Liberal to manage the economy. Well, after 6 years of such criticism from your side about debt and deficit, that must surprise you.
Look, Peter, there's obviously been some difficult decisions we've had to make in the budget, but, we can't continue as we have been. You can't just keep every year spending more money than you bring in. You can't do it as a family, you can't do it as a business, you can't do it as a government. And there are some difficult decisions in the budget, and obviously, people react to that in different ways. But we're very clear in what needs to be done to get things back on track, and we'll see it through and make the changes that we need for the country.
Realistically, Leanne, I mean, the simple fact is that from a Greens perspective in the Senate, if Labor decides to block something, you're probably going to be with them as well. There's too much ideological divide, isn't there, between what your view on how to manage the budget is versus what the view of the government is and what someone like David Coleman would advocate for.
Oh, well, we're certainly not voting consistently with Labor. Labor's often over there voting with the coalition. But right now, we are dealing with a brutal budget. And what David has said, there are tough decisions need to be made. Let's remember so much of the so-called budget crisis has been created. Classic tactics. A conservative government comes in, want to make out that, everything's in a desperate state. The state of the nation is collapsing. And what they've done is put a huge burden on mainly disadvantaged people, the unemployed, the sick, pensioners, are the people who are copping a set of policies that are not necessary. We're a rich country. The revenue is there. If we had the political will of a government to put in place a millionaire's tax, why don't we have a decent mining tax that, rather than allowing all those profits, billions of dollars, to go overseas, more of that money, to be retained in Australia for the public services the people of Australia have a right to expect.
What is the answer to that? Because we do hear these two things that, we've got a high marginal tax rate as an example compared to other OECD countries, but we've got low debt as a percentage of GDP compared to other countries. What do you accept, what do you reject out of what the Senator said?
A couple of points, Peter. Firstly, a debt massive increase. Labor had $50 billion in the bank when they came in, $200 billion of debt in a six-year period, and it's heading up towards two-thirds of a trillion if we don't do anything. So the
So you're saying there's a structural problem?
There is a significant structural problem, absolutely. And the mining tax that Lee brought up is a really good example of the contrasting approaches here. So what Labor and the Greens say is, let's introduce a mining tax. It has a negative impact on sentiment in that industry, raises $600,000 in a quarter.
I think the Senator would argue that that's a terrible mining tax, that she wants to see a much bigger one along the lines of the first version that Kevin Rudd tried to introduce.
Well that's probably true. She probably does want to see a bigger tax, but she also wants to see $10 billion of spending locked in against a tax that's raising $600,000 a quarter. And look, in some sort of parallel universe, that might make sense, but it doesn't make sense.
Well, let me get a reaction to that. That's a fair criticism, isn't it, Leanne? And you might not like the existing mining tax. You might prefer a better version, in your view, the Rudd original version that actually brings in some revenue. But given that we don't have that, and Labor isn't supporting going to that, you can't just stand by all the spending initiatives that are predicated on a tax that doesn't effectively raise any revenue, surely.
Well, yes, you can stand by it. We have a responsibility as Greens. That's what we were elected on, that platform. And the money is there. And let's remember, it wasn't Kevin Rudd's position in the first place. It actually came from Treasury. It was a very wise, responsible measure. Nothing revolutionary about it all. Just saying that the big miners should pay their fair share of tax. And that money should be there. And that's why we could have that spending programs. So it's the coalition that are running into problems. They're not managing the Senate very well, and they've got real problems in their own agenda, and they should be backing off and reassessing the state of play. You made the point about the polls. I mean, it's extraordinary how quickly the coalition have dropped. That should send them a message that their budget is unpopular and it's time to reassess.
Well, David Coleman, I want to get your reaction to what the moves are from here. That was my phone ringing. My wife, huge fan, obviously, of the program.
Indeed.
Regular watcher, doesn't even realise I'm on air. let me ask you about the budget. I mean, what is Plan B? Because Plan A is to get this budget through, and it looks like you're just not going to get it through. Some people, like Nick Xenophon on this program a few days ago, talked about the idea of a mini budget. There's always the threats of a double disillusion election. Now we hear today from Mark Riley's story the idea that maybe the money bills can have a lot more of the budget measures included in it as a way of getting around the Senate blocking it, I suppose. What's plan B and C, given that plan A ain't going to come off?
Well, look, you know, Peter, we're focused on getting our measures through. I mean, that's what, you know, governments are elected to do. We're not here to promote something other than the government's agenda. We're here to promote the government's agenda. And obviously we have a process in the Senate and there'll be lots of discussions there. I mean, let's not forget, I mean, these new senators, you know, they came in on the 1st of July and they were kind of expected to do quite a bit in the couple of days after they came in.
So you're hopeful, you remain hopeful that you'll be able to negotiate with the crossbenchers?
Absolutely. I mean, I think there's a respectful relationship there and you know, we won't agree on absolutely every single thing, but we'll have a respectful discussion. And you know, at the end of the day, people elect governments to pass budgets, and they expect governments to do that, and that's what we're completely focused on.
All right, we're almost out of time, but Senator Lee Rhiannon, a quick comment. This parliamentary committee that you're part of, you're jumping into bed with the major parties. You're trying to block other minor parties from entering the scene, it would seem, with the adjustments being recommended. It'll be a three-party system, or four, I guess, if you include the Nats, rather than any wider. Why are you trying to stifle various other views entering the Senate?
That's not the case at all. It's the exact opposite. In classic case, you shouldn't believe everything that you read. Look, we need reform, Senate electoral reform. The Greens long advocated it. We were successful in New South Wales in 1999 after that big giant tablecloth ballot paper. And it's a simple message. Voters should decide their preferences. It shouldn't be the backroom deals. That's why we have advocated supporting getting rid of group voting tickets that are used in upper house elections, were in New South Wales, still are in the Senate. It's time they went. Voters should make that decision. And we're pleased that Labor and the Coalition have actually agreed with us on that, and we will continue to advocate it.
Who would have thought we have ended the show with not just bipartisanship, but tripartisanship? Green Senator Lee Rhiannon in the Sydney City studio, and here David Coleman for the Liberal Party. Appreciate both your time this evening.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Good night.
Thank you.